Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Blessed Easter to you all. Today, we use a phrase in the church, and some of you know it, but if you don't, just repeat after me. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. We'll be saying that from time to time over the course of this worship service. This is St. John Lutheran Church in Louisville, Kentucky. We are a grace-based, Christ-centered community seeking to share the good news in what we do and what we say. And as our slide up here says, we are an Easter people. So I got a few announcements for you before we get started real quick. First of all, if you are online and you would like to receive information from the church or a visit or a prayer, then please put your contact information in the chat box and Bradley will have that recorded for us and we will reach out to you. If you are a guest or a visitor today, we are delighted by your presence. Your presence with us enriches our connection with God here. And if you don't mind and would like to receive some bread or some contact from the church, please fill out the welcome sheet that's in your bulletin. All right, so... Okay, so we put a challenge out a few weeks ago that we wanted to have 30 invitations or stories about St. John, about what God is doing at St. John. A few weeks ago we said this, and we wanted to have 30 invitations or stories. We've gone way over that at this point. And so we are thankful to God and to you all. Our goal is to have 75 by Easter, by Christmas. And I think we might be able to get way over that too. So... thank you all for making invitations. Thank you all for you all who have accepted invitations. And thank you all who have told any story at all about what God is doing at St. John here. Let's see. Okay. We would like to have Vacation Bible School the third week of July. We need some interest from five kids. By April the 16th, we've got interest from a couple of folks. So if you have someone in your life who is between the age of 4 and 6th grade, then and they might be interested in a fun time. We are doing our Vacation Bible School based on the ELCA World Hunger Appeal Vacation Bible School called Tree of Healing. So if you're interested in that, please let us know, and we will start planning for Vacation Bible School. Camp, it's time to start planning for camp. All kids, grades 1 through 11, have a great time at camp. It's a wonderful thing. You got hiking, you got swimming, you got archcraft, you got God. And our own Allie Lynch from this congregation is the program director for Lutheran Hills. It's only 2 weeks, 2 hours away. If you would like to go, we would like to put together a group of people to go to camp, and it will be a good time. So again, let me know if you're interested. The Hope Bus puts out 850 meals a week for people who are shelterless in our city of Louisville. They volunteer, they use many volunteers, and they use our kitchen in Young Hall. If you are interested in helping them, they cook on Tuesday nights at 5:30 and Saturdays at 11 o'clock. If you're interested in helping them clean and organize the kitchen, please see me. We're putting together a team for that as well. Now, St. Matthew's Area Ministry, helps people in our own neighborhood of St. Matthew's. And if you have food to bring for St. Matthew's Area Ministry, please drop it off in the hallway outside of Deal Hall. Also, St. Matthew's Area Ministry is moving from its current location at Beechwood Baptist to St. Matthew's United Methodist Church. And we have a list of folks who are interested in helping moving. So if you got strong arms and a good back, maybe you can give them a hand. We will be putting out a word asking for help in moving soon when the time comes. But if you'd like to do that, then let me know or write it down on one of the sheets that you have in the bulletin and put it in the offering plate and just say, help with moving. Is that good? What? Painting. All right, everybody is good at painting. Julie Abbott is the executive director of St. Matthew's Area Ministry. She's right in the back there. And we need painters too. So if you're good at painting, let us know. Okay, a week from this Friday night at 6:30, we are having movie night. We're gonna watch Willow, which in my opinion is the best fantasy movie of all time, even though it was made in 1988. So you know, we'll have a fun time coming out and we'll have some snacks and we'll sit in the library and watch a cool movie.
All right, I believe that's all for now. So I'd like to ask Deneen, please, to play us a brief prelude as we prepare for worship. Please stand. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, by whose hand we are given new birth, by whose speaking we are given new life. Amen. Because Christ is risen, we can come to God with humility and hope, seeking forgiveness and new birth. Therefore, let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit so that we may live and serve you with new life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
Christ is risen today. Alleluia. Our triumphant holy day. Alleluia. Who did once upon the cross. Alleluia. Suffer to redeem our loss.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
Worthy is Christ, the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. Power and riches and wisdom and strength, and honor and blessing and glory are His. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Sing with all the people of God and join in the hymn of all creation.
Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption. And by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Be seated. It is time for the children's sermon, and so I'm going to ask some of my helpers to bring some of the stuff up that we're going to use for the children's sermon. And anyone who wants to come forward for the children's sermon, we are asked, is invited to do so. All right. We got Thatcher, we got Layton, we got Lily, we got Elijah. This is just great. Oh, okay, make way. We gotta make way for our thing that we're making, okay? So we're gonna build this first. We're gonna build this together. Put this here. Here, Thatcher, why don't you get this box and put it over here. Can you put it over here? Here we go. All right, put it right down there. All right, we're gonna put this up here. Y'all need to get on the, there you go, that's it. Here we go. All right. And we're gonna put one on top here, like that. All right. And here we go, we got one here. Layton, you wanna help me put this box on the top? Thank you. Oh yeah, okay. All right, we got some more here. Elijah, you wanna get that one? Thank you, Miss Cindy. Can you carry that box around here to the front, please? Okay, now we are ready. But before, okay, ladies and gentlemen, this here is a tomb. You know what a tomb is? It's when somebody dies, sometimes they put them in a tomb. Okay, kind of scary? A little scary? Yeah, that's right, it's okay. It's okay for it to be scary. Because there's something deeper and more powerful than a tomb. But first, we got to deal with the slime. Okay? Ladies and gentlemen, we have slime in the house. Ladies and gentlemen, there is slime in the house. Do you think there's no slime for everybody? The thing about slime is slime. Who wants to goo their fingers? You goo your fingers slime?
Ew. Ew. All right. Everybody say 1, 2, 3, ew. Ew. 1, 2, 3. Ew. Yeah, that's right. You want to hold it? Can you hold it? All right. Thank you. All right. So the thing about slime is it gets your fingers all gooey and sticky and mushy, and you can't get your fingers out of it. And ew, and don't get it on the robes. For heaven's sake, you'll be in big trouble if you get it on Pastor Andy's robes or your. And so sometimes the slime gets so gooey that we can't even see through it. You can make slime like that. Makes a little screen, you can't see through it, and you're all stuck in the middle of the slime. And we need Jesus to get us out of the slime. And Jesus comes, and Jesus helps us, because we can't get out of the slime all on our own. I have a towel over there. Could you hand me one of those towels, please, Elijah? Not that one, that's got slime on it, the other one. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Here you go, Lynn. All right. Slime is like when we get bitter and hateful, and we don't care about what anybody else thinks, and we get lazy, and we want everybody to give us stuff without even working for it. And when we think we're better than everybody else, and everybody else has to do whatever we say instead of listening, right? And when we forget about how to take care of our own souls and bodies, slime. Okay? Jesus came to get us out of the slime. And how did Jesus do that? Jesus died on the cross. Okay. Can you put that back, please, sir? On the railing. Thank you. Now, when Jesus died, they put him in a tomb. Sometimes when we get out of the slime, we have to stand up for what's right. And maybe our friends might make fun of us if we stand up for what's right. Or somebody might get mad at us for standing up for what's right. And so sometimes we have to go to the cross too a little bit, right? In order to help people and to stand up for what's right. So maybe even sometimes we end up in a tomb. I know it's on his fingers here. Let's get that. A little bit more slime. You know, one time doesn't do it. We still have slime even after Jesus helps us, isn't it? All right. Is that good? All right. So sometimes we might get stuck in a tomb. Sometimes Christians are put in tombs. And sometimes we... You want to go in a tomb? You don't want to? You don't have to. You don't want to. I'll come in with you. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. What happens to tombs in the church? Huh? Yeah, but then what did Jesus do? He rose from the dead. He rose from the dead. Yeah. So you want to be a part of busting out the tomb? You don't? You really don't? Okay, well, let's show you what it's like, and then you might change your mind. You ready? Okay, so when I say Christ is risen, and you say he is risen indeed, Christ is risen indeed, hallelujah, we're going to bust out of this tomb. You ready? We're going to do this together. You want to do it on your own? You're on your own. Okay. Jesus got in the tomb, and they thought he was dead, and it was very sad because death had won, and dead things don't come back, but Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. That's what happened. Now, do you want to bust out the tomb? Yeah, okay, come on. Here we go. Everybody wants to go in. Well, that's kind of up to you, Elijah, how much you want to explode the tomb. You could explode that way, you could explode that way. You want to come in? No, you sure? You sure? You're sure? Okay, you don't want to. All right, here we go. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. That's the greatest thing in the world. This was Lily's idea. All right, here we go. We're going to put these away, and we'll go on with the Bible passages today. Yeah. Here we go. Elijah, can you carry that one?
Layton, you want to help me carry this part of the, you want to carry one of the boxes back with me? Can you do it yourself? You want to help? Can you do it? Okay, good, good. All right. Thank you all. Thank you.
Happy Easter. Our first reading is from Acts chapter 10, beginning at the 34th verse. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read responsively Psalm 118. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. God's mercy endures forever.
Israel now declare God's mercy endures forever.
The Lord is my strength and my song, and has become my salvation.
Shouts of rejoicing and salvation echo in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord acts valiantly.
The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord acts valiantly.
I shall not die, but live, and declare the works of the Lord.
The Lord indeed punished me sorely, but did not hand me over to death.
Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. Here the righteous may enter.
I give thanks to you, for you have answered me, and you have become my salvation.
The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
By the Lord has this been done. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The second reading is from Colossians chapter 3. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'm so glad Jesus has lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me.
According to John, glory to you, O Lord. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the tomb had been removed, that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head lying, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me.
Be seated. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. This means new life for everyone. That's what it means. In the gospel lesson for today, Mary Magdalene, she doesn't quite understand what's going on. She goes through a journey of growing, a journey of discovery, a journey of wonder, in fact. She starts out and she has an inkling that something is going on with Jesus, that Jesus brings the new life of God. But she thinks that Jesus has been killed. She even sees Jesus, and she thinks he's the gardener. She thinks that somebody has taken Jesus away. And so Jesus calls her name. He says, Mary. And now she recognizes him as her beloved teacher, the teacher that has touched her soul, that has brought her into the space of being able to talk and think about God in clear ways. And so she thinks he's the teacher. She says, Rabboni, to him. And he reveals to her that he's more than just a teacher now. That the intimacy, the unity, the life and the love of God that he had between himself and God has now opened up and embraced her and us. New life. Now, Mary's journey from kind of understanding less to understanding more is absolutely common in the Gospel of John. We have seen it for weeks here in church. We saw it with Nicodemus several weeks ago. We saw it with the woman at the well. We saw it with the man who was born blind. We saw it with Mary and Martha a couple of weeks ago, and now Mary also grows. That's why the reason for that is because this is how we are. We don't understand everything about God and Jesus. We don't have all the answers. We are lucky if we have any of the right questions, in fact. What we do have is a sense that there is new life here, that Jesus brings new life. There is something beyond the tomb. And our whole lives, the Christian life, is a journey of discovery and of wonder. I suspect that eternal life is an eternal journey of discovery and growth and wonder, continual new ways of understanding the infinite beauty of God. So here's a bit of an example to try to explain something of what I mean. My wife, Thine, that's her name, Thine. My wife, Thine, grew up in a family that did not go to church. They were a loving family, and if you had been able to persuade them to put a label on themselves, which you probably would never be able to persuade them to put a label on themselves because they were allergic to labels, they might have taken on the label of humanist, you see. A humanist is a person who sees purpose and meaning in the good things that people can do. And so in her family, they valued integrity and honesty to a high degree. And they tried to treat people with respect, both one another and folks who were from different backgrounds and cultures and things like that. They could not stand pretense and snootiness. And they had a great value in compassion for people. Compassion. They were good people. Still are. They found expression of the deep things of life, the deep things of being human, in the form of art and music and good food and celebration and being together. But Thine had... Thine had questions, and Thine had wonderments. Questions are holy. Questions are keys to growth and understanding. So one day when she was in college, at Earlham College, she went to a church. I won't say which church, and unfortunately the church was having a conflict, which conflict is okay. There's nothing wrong with conflict. If you don't have conflict, you don't grow. But conflict has to be managed appropriately. You have to manage your conflict. You have to have rules. You have to be able to talk to each other in respectful ways and listen to each other. And usually you can find a solution that neither side had thought of before. That's the way to deal with conflict in this particular church. As happens, never happens in any of our churches, does it? When you have a badly managed conflict, and people are standing up there praying for one thing, and then they pray for a completely opposite thing. Yes. So that kind of turned her off. It wasn't the first time that somebody seeking and wondering was turned off by conflict in the church, and it won't be the last. She went on to earn a degree in nursing. And she was a pediatric nurse, that is somebody who takes care of babies and children. And then she went into the Peace Corps. Now, in the Peace Corps, you go to another country, and you might live in this other country for a couple of years. In her case, it was a year and a half. She went to the African nation of Niger, which is on the edge of the Sahara Desert. Now, in Niger, you do not come home after work and sit in your air-conditioned apartment or home and drink your grenadine and your orange juice or your cocktail and relax yourself. This is not what happens when you are a neonatal nurse in Niger. In Niger, you have a simple, maybe one-room home or two-room place to live, and you will get your air conditioning, and they told them this in the Peace Corps, by putting wet towels over yourself and laying down underneath the fan. You're lucky if you've got a fan, and that will cool you down. In Niger, they don't have the same medical facilities nor the same respect for Western medicine as they have here. And indeed, at that time, they didn't even have doctors. So China would send doctors. They didn't have any money at this point. China didn't, now they do. But they didn't have any money at that point. China didn't. And so they would send people and they would send doctors. Of course, they would keep the doctors' families back home in China. Yes, they did. And the doctors would be there in Niger helping at the hospital. And also, she worked with some very, very, very dedicated nurses from Niger itself, from the country of Niger. And one of them was her friend, I want to remember her by name, Mariama. Mariama was one of the nurses that she worked with. And all of these people were working together to help folks who were sick. And they didn't have modern medicine. They had to reuse needles, and they had to try to sterilize them or keep them clean as possible. They couldn't get new needles all the time. But the doctors were dedicated. There was Dr. Lee, for example, who worked with Thine, and he would, and the other doctors, about 18 of them, would invite Thine over, across the street. She lived across the street from them, and she would invite her over for a movie night, and they would get these movies from China, and Dr. Lee would translate the movie into English as they're watching the movie, and they'd have dinner, and they'd play ping pong. And I don't know what the motivations of the Chinese government was sending their doctors to Niger, but I do know that Dr. Lee was a good person. And he was trying to help people. And that was hard, because as I say, in Niger, they didn't trust Western medicine, and so the hospital would often be the last resort, and people would carry their babies and their children when they were really, really sick, and they would carry them for miles and miles and miles and miles across the countryside, the people who lived in the countryside. And the countryside is not like our countryside. Our countryside, with its pastures and its fallow fields and its crops, you can walk by there and it's relatively pleasant. In Niger, it's like the American Southwest. In the dry season, that's what it looks like. And then in the wet season, the rainy season, it gets a little bit more vegetation. People can grow a little bit more. And they would carry their children over these vast distances, over this arid landscape, bring them to the hospital. And by the time they got there to the hospital, the child was too far gone. Or the baby was too far gone. And they couldn't save the baby or the child. So even though they helped a lot of people, Thine and Dr. Lee and Mariama, they saw a lot of children die. Of stupid stuff, like measles. You know, measles, we have a vaccine for measles. And maybe when we've seen a child die of measles, we will understand the incredible gift from God that vaccines are. And the children who would die of measles, they would not have enough to eat. And so their bodies weren't strong enough to fight off the infection. And the measles would get down in their throats and their lungs and stuff like that, and they would die. Well, we have enough food in the world to feed everybody. It's a matter of getting it where it needs to go. And children would die of dysentery, of diarrhea, because they didn't have enough drinking water that was clean and clear. This is stupid, because we can get clean drinking water to people. And I'm not saying this as a criticism to the United States or even of the rich countries, although we also bear a responsibility. This is everybody in the world, our species. We are not good people. Because we can't get it together. To make sure everybody has enough to eat and a clean drink of water and vaccines. Children died. So Thein came back from the Peace Corps, and she decided she wanted to address public health problems on a larger scale. More children would be assisted. And so she went to UCLA and got a master's degree in public health, and she worked her way through that program by being a nurse at night, a pediatric nurse at night in the neonatal intensive care unit. That's the part of the hospital where they take care of the little babies who are really in trouble. Okay, and lots of those babies, they were able to help those babies and bring them back into greater health, and they went on to live full lives. And some of those babies they couldn't do anything for, and they died. And very often the parents, usually one or at least one, and usually both of the parents would be there for the little baby, for the child, so that the child didn't have to die alone. But sometimes the parents weren't able to be there. And when that happened, Thein would go and sit with the baby in the middle of the night. And she would tell the baby that it was going to be okay. And that the baby was going to go to God. This is before Thein became a Christian. Not a Christian yet. Not baptized. Didn't go to church. So after she got her master's degree in public health, she went on to University of Michigan, where I eventually met her, and she earned a doctorate in population studies, because the growth of population directly and strongly influences children's health and people's health. Okay, so she was interested in this, and so she was working on her PhD at the University of Michigan, and she had a friend named Bruce Christensen. Now, Bruce was a good old Minnesota Lutheran, one of those quiet bachelor types. Bruce Christensen was like in his mid-30s, and he acted like he was 85. You ever meet people like this? They're like I know people. There are people in my family that are like in their 20s, and they act like they're 70, okay? This guy, he was 35, and he acted like he was 85. He drove like he was 93. You know what I'm talking about? He would drive through town at the speed limit, okay? So if it was 25 miles an hour, he'd be driving through town at 25 miles an hour, and he'd have five cars behind him, everybody in them popping a coronary because his car in front of him is going so slow. This is Bruce Christensen. So Bruce, he goes to Germany to see the Luther sites, you know, Wittenberg University where Luther taught, and Wartburg Castle where he translated the Bible and all that. He goes to Germany, and he comes back. He's telling all his friends, including Thein, about his trip to Germany, okay, and all the Lutheran places. And Thein says, "Well, you go to church?" And Bruce says, "Yeah, I go to church. I go to Lord of Light, a Lutheran church over here. That's the campus ministry, the student congregation at University of Michigan, ELCA campus ministry over there." And then Bruce says to Thein, he says, "Would you like to come to Bible study with me on Wednesday night?" Okay. So I have two asides in this story. Here's the first aside. First aside, okay. If Bruce Christensen, who drives 25 miles an hour through town, can invite somebody to church or to a church event, so can we, right? Yes. All you got to do is pray about it, and when the time is right, make the invite. No pressure. We're not threatening anybody. We're not trying to force anybody or anything like that. But if somebody has questions or wonderments or would like a blessing or a sense of peace, all right, then we have something to offer. And if you have come because of an invitation, that is a great gift to us. It really is. All right, back to the story. So she goes with Bruce to the Bible study at Lord of Light Lutheran Church for two or three, four, I don't know how many times. And eventually she walks into the campus pastor's office. The campus pastor's name is Galen Ora. So he goes into Pastor Galen's office and she says, I have a question. Remember, questions are holy. She says, I have a question. I need to know, you see. Because I was in the Peace Corps, and when I was in the Peace Corps, I saw a lot of babies die. And they weren't baptized. Because, you know, Niger is a Muslim country. They weren't baptized. I need to know whether you think those babies are in hell right now. And Galen says, no. That's not part of my theology. In other words, to the best of my discernment from what I read in Scripture and what I see in the world, I don't think that's what God is like. So then Thine said, well, I have some more questions for you then. And they had conversations over a period of time after that, and eventually Thine was baptized at the age of 35 at Lord of Light Lutheran Church, the ELCA campus ministry at University of Michigan. Okay, second aside from the story. Thank you. I'm going to say thank you to you all. Because campus ministry is something the ELCA does, and you support the ELCA's work by your presence here, by your prayers, by the money you put in the offering plate, and by your attitude toward the church. And all of that makes something like this happen, this story. Stories like this happen because of what God is doing through you. Through your presence, through your prayers, through your money, and through your attitude, God does miracles. So thank you for being a part of the presence of God in the life of somebody who is really, really, really important to me. Okay, so I tell you that whole big long story because, you see, pastors are human beings. And we get discouraged sometimes, all right? And sometimes we pastors, you know, people don't do the things we think they should do, or things don't happen as fast as we think they should happen, and we get afraid that the church will die, or we get afraid that we're gonna fail somehow. And so we go home and we whine to our spouses, which we should not do, right? But one day I was whining to my spouse. I was at one of my former parishes and I was discouraged. And I was saying, what are we here for? What is a church here for? Are we here just to worship together and to sing songs and make ourselves feel good? Is that why we are here? Are we here as a social service agency to help other people? And if that's the only reason why we are here, then why are we wasting all this money on these chapels, huh? Why are we here? Are we here? Are we just a salvation club where all of us who belong to the group, we get to get into heaven, but all you folks outside, too bad for you. Is that why we're here? What are we here for? And my wife, Thine, who had seen so much stupid death, says, we're here for new life. That's what it's about. New life. We don't have all the answers. We don't understand everything. We are on a journey of growth and discovery and learning. Yes, we are. But we have been touched. We have been moved by a glimpse, a glimmering, a reality of new life. New life. And we all have bumps, and we all have challenges, and we all have slime in our lives. But that new life is deeper than the slime, deeper than the tomb. And that's why we're here. Because we want to be a part of it, and we want to grow. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please sit or kneel.
United in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need.
You call your church to witness to your salvation. We give thanks for all theologians, preachers, and teachers who proclaim your gospel. Equip all the baptized to share the joy of the resurrection in all we say and do. Risen Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You bring abundant life throughout creation. The green blade rises, and all creation greets the resurrection dawn. Preserve vineyards and orchards and those who tend to them. Feed us with the fruits of creation. Risen Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You show your steadfast love without regard to borders, barriers, or human-made divisions. Infuse your justice in every nation of the world. Bring peace to Ukraine and an end to famine in Afghanistan, Central America, Haiti, Myanmar, Yemen, and the Horn of Africa, that all experience the peace that only you can give. Risen Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You anointed your Son with the Holy Spirit and with power. Encourage us by his example in our ministries of healing, care, and outreach. We pray for all healthcare workers and all who are sick or hospitalized, especially those we name now before you. Beth
Hurst. Suprith, RJ, Paula.
Risen Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
As you have raised Jesus from the dead, you show us your resurrection promise. With your holy ones who have sung your praise, free us from fear and empower us to go and tell the good news. Risen Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Rejoicing in the victory of Christ's resurrection, we lift our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Thank you. Please stand.
Let the vineyards be fruitful, Lord, and fill to the brim our cup of blessing. Gather the harvest from the seeds that were sown, that we may be fed with the bread of life. Gather the hopes and dreams of all, unite them with the prayers we offer. Grace our table with your presence, and give us a foretaste of the feast to come.
Let us pray. Generous God, in this meal you offer your very self, we give thanks for these gifts of the earth, and the breaking of this bread reveal to us the risen one, and the pouring of this wine pour us out in service to the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. You created earth and heaven. You saved your world from the waters of the flood. You brought your people out of slavery through the sea into the promised land. You came to us as Jesus, your anointed one, who taught us and healed us, who wept for us and loved us, who died and rose for our salvation, and who this day pours your Holy Spirit on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life, and thus proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Grace our table with your presence. Raise us up as the body of Christ to do your work of love in the world. Come, Holy Spirit.
with your holy ones of every time and place, with earth and all its creatures, sun, moon, stars, and mysteries of the universe. We praise you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Be seated.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Grant us peace.
Body of Christ, given for you. Body of Christ, given for you. The body of Christ, given for you.
Body of Christ, given for you.
Amen.
Please stand. Oh, be seated. Sorry.
Thank you. the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Amen.
Alle, alle, alle.
Gracious God, in you we live and move and have our being. With your word and this meal of grace, you have nourished our life together. Strengthen us to show your love and serve the world in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Christians, hasten on your way. Alleluia. Offer praise and love repeat. Alleluia. At the Paschal victim's feet.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Go in peace. Tell what God has done.
Sharing Jesus through worship, learning, caring, and service. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
talk to the pastor Andy between services.